Ada.
Wanu Alia Fakiha.
Ada.
Okey, Wanu Nabila.
Okey, teacher.
Okey, Alifi pergi mana Alifi?
Mak panggil tadi jap.
Okey, as I promised last time, we are going to dwell a little bit on the health issues related to human reproductive system. And I'm going to show you two videos. Previously, if you happen to look at questions from past years especially, you might come across questions related to apa kita panggil? Family planning. Okay, that was part of the syllabus before, but for your new syllabus, that has been taken out. It's good additional reading. If you come across it, then just simply read. Tapi, based on your syllabus, that apparently is not part of the syllabus anymore. So I'm not going to show you those things. Okay, family planning, dia ada a few things lah. Okay, there are a few technologies related to that. Tapi teacher tak pasti kalau teacher perlu go into that. We will have to see kalau dalam SPM atau dalam trial nanti keluar those kind of questions. Kalau ada, then I will add on later lah. But for now, I will be sticking to only two things. Okay, ada dua teknologi yang teacher nak tunjuk pada you, which is artificial insemination. Yang tu tak disebut dalam buku teks you, tapi it could actually be one form of treatment. Kita akan tengok when it's being used. Dan yang kedua yang commonly being mentioned quite a lot, which is IVF lah. It's not required for you to know the procedure secara detail, but I'm simply showing it to you supaya you faham what happened masa the treatment. Okay, because the topic itself has been very much simplified kepada you, 15.6 dalam buku teks you tu. Cuma I'm kind of worried sebab soalan dia lebih berbentuk the question that I saw daripada syllabus baru lebih berbentuk the question dalam activity zone tu. Bermaksud it seems that untuk 15.6 you do have to actually do some outside reading on your own. Okay, so activity zone dalam buku teks you page 302 tu tolong buat. Okay, I will give this to you as assignment untuk hantar. Ini teacher nak suruh you buat dalam bentuk essay. Okay, so yang ni you akan buat later lah. I will give you the date, deadline bila untuk you buat. Read about it, then tulis essay dan hantar kepada teacher. Tapi for today, I will share with you two videos that discuss about treatment for impotency atau infertility. Okay, I mentioned last time, the terms tu benda yang sama. Buku teks you guna perkataan impotency. Most of the other resources menggunakan perkataan infertility lah. Okay, dia benda yang sama. Okay, let's take a look at ini dulu. Teacher share pada you artificial insemination. It's a process that usually dia akan cerita dalam video ni pada you that is being done untuk treat selalunya masalah male impotency, okay, which is due to low sperm count atau low sperm quality. Okay, but you will see ada a few things yang ditambah nanti dalam video ni. I will expand on that later.
Intrauterine insemination, also known as artificial insemination, is a procedure done to help a woman get pregnant. A woman's reproductive system includes the vagina, cervix, uterus, fallopian tubes, and ovaries. During the monthly menstrual cycle, one of her ovaries releases an egg in a process called ovulation. After ovulation, the egg enters the fallopian tube. A woman is most likely to become pregnant if she has sex in the days just before, during, or right after ovulation. During this time, a sperm cell from a man's reproductive fluid, called semen, is able to fertilize her egg as it moves through the fallopian tube. Intrauterine insemination may be performed if a woman is having trouble getting pregnant, a condition known as infertility. Or it may be done if a woman wants to have a child without a male partner. Before intrauterine insemination, a woman may receive fertility medication that causes her to release more than one egg during ovulation. In a process called sperm washing, a man's sperm will be separated from the fluid in his semen. This concentrates the sperm, removes debris, and removes hormones that may cause the uterus to cramp. If the male partner is completely infertile, also known as sterile, or if the woman does not have a male partner, previously washed and frozen donor sperm will be used for the procedure. The doctor will monitor the ovaries for ovulation. Intrauterine insemination must be performed right before or right after a woman ovulates, so that an egg is available for fertilization. During the procedure, the woman will lie on an examination table. A tool called a speculum will be inserted into her vagina so that the doctor can see her cervix. A syringe will be loaded with a small amount of fluid containing the washed sperm. Then the syringe will be attached to a long, thin tube called a catheter. The doctor will insert the catheter into the vagina. The tip of the catheter will be guided through the opening in the cervix and into the uterus. Once the catheter is inside the uterus, the doctor will inject the sperm. Then, the catheter and speculum will be removed. The woman may continue to lie on her back for about 10 minutes.
Okay.
Into her vagina.
All right. Ini the video showing pada you the procedure that is done kalau a couple opt to do in artificial insemination atau dipanggil intrauterine insemination. Intrauterine tu maksudnya dalam uterus. Okay. And this is normally done for two reasons. Sama ada infertility. Okay. And as I mentioned tadi, infertility could be due to low sperm count, okay, untuk male, because kalau dia produce low sperm count, itu bermaksud entry yang biasa bila sperm masuk dalam vagina perempuan, what would usually happen is that the female reproductive system, dia ada dia punya defense mechanism dia sendiri, okay, which include mucus and white blood cell lah. So the mucus akan trap most of the sperm. So kalau the male itself dah produce sperm yang sikit, chance untuk sperm to remain dan boleh pergi kepada the ovum yang ada dalam fallopian tube will be very low. Because of that, this method will allow dia untuk bypass those halangan lah, so to speak. So tak perlu nak go through mucus, tak perlu nak overcome the female defense system. Kita letak terus dia dalam uterus, okay? Or the same situation boleh berlaku kalau the male sperm is of low quality. Maksudnya dia tak boleh nak berenang jauh. So kita bantu dia lah in a sense. Letakkan terus the sperm tu di tempat yang tak perlu dia berenang jauh atau tak perlu dia berenang susah. But it could also be due to the problem with female. Okay, I mentioned tadi female dia ada mucus lining dalam dia punya vagina and cervix as well up to the uterus. So in some female, the mucus might be a bit too thick. Okay, dia menghasilkan terlalu banyak mucus that even if the male menghasilkan sperm yang banyak pun, the sperm masih tak boleh nak overcome the mucus layer. So the female mungkin perlu bantuan, kita insert terus the concentrated sperm tadi masuk dalam uterus so that dia tak perlu nak overcome too much blockage. That way kita ensure higher chance untuk sperm tu survive dan boleh fertilize the egg. Okay, itu satu. Point kedua yang ditulis dekat sini, ini biasanya dia akan melibatkan ethical issue, okay, dan religious issue lah. Untuk Muslim, teacher bagi tahu sekarang tak boleh, okay. Point kedua tak dibenarkan di Malaysia, tak boleh, Okay, we are not allowed to request for sperm donor if the female nak ada anak without male partner. Islam tak benarkan, sebab itu hukumnya berzina lah. Okay, so tolong be aware of this. Kita share ni sebab I saw ada a few times soalan yang keluar melibatkan ethical issue. Dia tanya apa ethical issue yang terlibat atau religious issue. Itulah biasanya masalahnya ialah this option is available if the female, dia mention dua keadaan tadi. Okay. Okay, di sini mana tadi? Okay. Dia mention dua keadaan. Either dia collect the sperm daripada the male partner atau dia collect the sperm daripada male donor. Okay, donor tu dia datang daripada sperm bank lah. Malaysia kita ada sperm bank, tapi sperm bank tu hanya untuk kegunaan married couple, legally married couple. Okay, kalau di negara-negara yang bukan Islam, they do have donor, apa tu, sperm bank dan ovum bank datang daripada donor. The information itself is classified lah. Tapi if let's say I'm not a Muslim, okay, let's say, okay, dan teacher nak ada anak tanpa any partner, I can actually request lah untuk pay for sperm daripada donor. Okay, and I can pick daripada, biasanya dia ada katalog macam tu. Dia tak bagi tahu siapa, tapi dia bagi tahu karakteristik of the sperm donor. Macam tu lah. However, that is highly unethical in Malaysia and that is haram dalam Islam. Okay, so tolong fahami that point dalam video ni. I will share the video dekat Telegram. I remember I forgot to share the video last time. Tapi yang ni teacher akan share as well on Telegram. So, kalau you decide untuk tengok lagi sekali dan fahami apa yang diceritakan, tolong proceed with caution lah. Okay, the options yang ditulis dekat sini tak semestinya available di Malaysia. Okay, it's not allowed in Malaysia. Kita tak boleh. Kalau nak ambil sperm donation, kena kahwin lah dengan that partner. Alright. So, this is actually that straightforward enough. Alright, I will show kejap lagi pada you IVF. IVF dia melibatkan more procedure simply because for IVF, both the sperm and the ovum is actually extracted out dan banyak prosedurnya berlaku di luar badan. Okay. So, yang tu kita akan discuss a bit more. Yang ni kita tunjuk hanya untuk apa tu, bring to your attention the possible ethical and religious issues related to this particular technology. Ini bukan teknologi baru, dia teknologi yang dah agak lama digunakan dan ada optionnya di Malaysia. Okay, cuma hanya dibenarkan untuk Islam, pasangan yang dah berkahwin lah. I think even for non-Muslim pun dia hanya akan buat untuk legally married patients. Dia tak bagi kepada orang yang tak ada partner. It's probably illegal untuk buat di Malaysia. I don't know if there is any country di Asia ni yang izinkan benda tu. As far as I know, if you, oh tak tahulah you follow ke tak kan, if you follow cerita-cerita Korea ke something, you might come across ada one female celebrity yang decide nak buat benda tu, however dia tak boleh get it done in Korea because it's not legal. Okay, so there is that issue lah. For, as far as I know, kebanyakan sperm bank atau ovum bank ni ada di negara-negara barat lah, the US or the UK. Okay, they do have that quite commonly and most people boleh access dia. Okay, and bear in mind, sperm bank dan ovum bank is where you store the sperm and ovum extracted out from the donor. Okay, untuk Malaysia, I mentioned tadi ovum bank pun ada. Itu salah satu teknologi. Kalau you boleh baca, take note sekarang apa yang teacher mention ni. Catat poin-poin teacher. You want to read a bit more about sperm bank. Okay, bank B-A-N-K. Okay. Sperm bank and ovum bank. Ovum bank untuk Muslim rasanya it's quite available, cuma it's expensive lah. Now what you can do is sekarang, ini satu lagi teknologi lah. Because many of the female sekarang mungkin kahwin lambat. So I mentioned previously, because females are born with set number of apa tu, ovum. Okay, so over time the ovum punya quality will decrease. So kalau the female tu tahu dia tak ada, belum ada male partner, tapi dia plan untuk ada anak in the future, they can actually pay untuk extract dia punya ovum masa ovum dia masih high quality and store dia. Okay, biasanya dia akan buat cryopreservation lah. Dia akan store dalam liquid nitrogen. Okay, simpan supaya kualiti ovum dia tu terjaga. The next time dia nak, dia dah kahwin, dia nak ada anak, dia boleh access the ovum again untuk buat IVF lah. In that case, biasanya dia akan opt untuk in vitro fertilization. Okay? Boleh faham ke tu? Apa yang teacher share ni, anak-anak?
Boleh.
Okay, boleh. Sebab I do need to discuss this. Sebab apa yang teacher tengok dalam soalan, dia untuk health issues related to reproduction ni, dia banyak melibatkan teknologi tu lah. Okay, teacher bimbang kalau teacher tak expose dan tak discuss dengan you, pembacaan you tak sampai. Okay, now I'm going to share to you the procedure untuk IVF. Okay, again, teacher lupa nak mention disclaimer tadi. Again, what I'm showing to you dalam kelas and discussing with you dalam kelas is purely for biological purposes. Okay. So kalau ada ibu bapa you terdengar discussion kita, tolong terangkan betul-betul. Alright, tolong fahami because these issues akan could affect every single one of you. If you approach it without knowledge, then chances are you won't be able to settle the problem. Okay, so sebab tu dia include dalam you punya syllabus. Okay, alright, I'll share to you the procedure untuk IVF sekarang.
In vitro fertilization is a process where a woman's eggs are fertilized outside her body, then placed back inside her body to help her get pregnant. A woman's reproductive system includes the vagina, cervix, uterus, fallopian tubes, and ovaries. During the monthly menstrual cycle, one of the ovaries releases an egg in a process called ovulation. After ovulation, the egg enters the fallopian tube. A woman is most likely to become pregnant if she has sex in the days just before, during, or right after ovulation. During this time, a sperm cell from a man's reproductive fluid, called semen, is able to fertilize the egg just inside the fallopian tube. As it travels along the fallopian tube, the fertilized egg, now called an embryo, loses the outer cells that nourished it in the ovary. The embryo passes from the fallopian tube into the uterus. In the uterus, the embryo sheds its protective outer layer, called the zona pellucida, in a process called zona hatching. Zona hatching is necessary for the embryo to implant in the tissue lining the uterus. During implantation, a connection between the woman and the embryo begins to grow. This organ, called the placenta, allows oxygen and nutrients to pass from her to the embryo. In vitro fertilization may be performed if a woman has been having trouble getting pregnant, a condition known as infertility, or it may be done if a woman wants to have a child without a male partner. Before in vitro fertilization, a woman will receive fertility medication that causes more than one egg to grow and mature in the ovaries. A man will add a semen sample so that the healthiest sperm can be collected for fertilization. If the male partner is completely infertile, also known as sterile, or the woman doesn't have a male partner, a donor may be arranged to provide sperm for this process. In vitro fertilization consists of three main procedures: follicle aspiration, fertilization, and embryo transfer. During the first procedure, called follicle aspiration, eggs will be harvested from the ovaries. At the beginning of this procedure, an ultrasound probe will be inserted into the woman's vagina so that her doctor can view her ovaries. Inside the ovaries, the doctor will look for follicles. Each follicle is a fluid-filled sac that contains an egg. Then the doctor will insert a long thin needle into and through the wall of her vagina and guide it to the ovary. A suction device connected to the needle will collect several eggs from inside their follicles. During the second part of in vitro fertilization, called fertilization, collected eggs will be taken immediately to a laboratory where they will be fertilized. Fertilization may be performed by insemination, where several sperm are mixed with the healthiest eggs. Or the eggs may be fertilized with sperm injected directly into them during a process called intracytoplasmic sperm injection. The fertilized eggs, also called embryos, will be monitored for 3 to 5 days as they begin to grow. At this time, the lab may create a hole in the zona pellucida surrounding some of the embryos. This process, called assisted hatching, will help these embryos implant in the uterus. Some of the embryos will be used right away for embryo transfer. The rest will be frozen and stored for future use if necessary. The third part of in vitro fertilization is called embryo transfer, which is done 3 to 5 days after fertilization. During embryo transfer, a tool called a speculum will be inserted into the woman's vagina so that the doctor can see her cervix. A syringe will be loaded with fluid containing one or more of the hatched embryos. Then the syringe will be attached to a long thin tube called a catheter. The doctor will insert the catheter into the vagina, through the cervix, and into the uterus. Once inside the uterus, the doctor will inject the embryos. Then the catheter and speculum will be removed. The woman may continue to lie on her back for about 15 minutes.
Okay, itu is the procedure untuk IVF. All right, you can see that it's slightly different daripada IUI tadi. Okay, but reason dia, kalau you tengok di sini, dia simplifynya sama macam IUI tadi. So what I want you to do untuk reasons, okay, which treatment you want to choose. Number one, kita nak restrict kepada what you have in your textbook. Okay, your textbook mentioned that if you have problem with hormone, then you akan buat hormone therapy. Okay, kalau you ada blocked fallopian tube atau blocked sperm duct, then you akan go for surgery. If you have any other problem, okay, then selalunya you akan go for in vitro fertilization. Okay, so itu merangkumi infertility lah. And as I mentioned tadi, having children without male partner is not allowed in Islam. Okay, however, it is an option yang available to non-Muslims di luar negara lah. Okay, di Malaysia kita tak izinkan sebab kita negara Islam. Okay, so do be aware that it is possible for female atau for male untuk dapatkan anak without ever having a partner. Okay, kalau untuk male prosesnya lebih complicated lah sebab dia perlu cari ovum donor dan dia perlu cari surrogate mother, ibu tumpang. Okay, untuk perempuan dia hanya perlu cari the sperm donor sahaja. Okay, so kalau you tengok dekat sini prosesnya ada tiga. Okay, requirementnya ada tiga. Memang the female akan diberi fertility medication sebab selalunya problem infertility yang require IVF ni dia agak kompleks. Sometimes it's due to dia punya follicle dia tak cukup elok ataupun it's due to blockage dalam fallopian tube atau it's due to combination of several problems. So biasanya doktor akan bagi fertility medication untuk make sure follicle growth. Okay, kalau you tengok tadi prosesnya tadi kat sini, follicle aspiration ni, apa yang dia buat kat sini ialah dia suluh, doktor akan suluh untuk tengok dalam ovary perempuan ada kedok follicle yang elok. Okay, kalau perempuan tu tak ada follicle yang elok, meaning that they can't actually produce good usable ovum, dan itu bermaksud dia terpaksa bergantung kepada apa tu, ovum donation lah. Okay, dia sendiri memang tak akan boleh pregnant lah. That is a situation di mana IVF pun tak mampu nak solve it. Okay, kalau dia memang tak boleh hasilkan ovum. This procedure is only doable if the female can produce healthy ovum. Okay, kalau tak boleh keluarkan pun tak apa. As long as dalam ovary dia ada healthy ovum. Okay, and what doctors will do is dia akan ambil beberapa. Sebab tu dia perlu bagi hormone treatment. Sebab kalau bergantung kepada hormon biasa manusia hasilkan, your body will only allow usually satu follicle to grow per month. Okay. Tapi untuk treatment ni, doktor nak beberapa follicle growing at the same time. So dia bagi hormone treatment, usually high dose of FSH, supaya multiple follicle will develop at the same time, and dia akan aspirate. Aspirate ni ialah extract keluar. Okay. Dan aspiration memang dia buat beginilah prosesnya, cucuk jarum. Okay, through the vagina to the ovary. Okay, so that is actually a very painful procedure lah. Sebab tu untuk IVF ni, treatment dia bukan treatment yang sekejap. Okay, if you inquire, kalau you baca atau kalau teacher, I bukan datang from my experience tapi from stories daripada kawan-kawan lah, because I'm at the age where my friends are already married dan ada yang a few of them yang mencuba this procedure. So I'm aware of the procedure. It's a long process. The hormonal treatment itself akan ambil masa beberapa minggu up to months sebelum dia ready untuk extract the follicle tu. Okay. So and it's very painful as well as very costly. Kalau di Malaysia ada dua option lah. Sama ada you buat di hospital kerajaan. Hospital kerajaan tu memang kena queue lah. Tunggu turn you sangat lama. Mungkin akan ambil masa berbulan-bulan. And cost dia probably, it's actually quite close to 10K juga, 10,000. Okay, kalau you pergi kepada hospital swasta, you might not have to queue lama, tapi costnya almost double that lah. Okay, so in vitro fertilization bukan sesuatu yang murah untuk dibuat, sebab tu it's not an option that everyone can choose lah. Okay, it's an option, a treatment option yang boleh membantu ramai orang, tapi ada a few issues with that lah. So salah satunya ialah the cost. Number two is it could be painful, and for what I know, most of the female yang buat IVF ni, because it's not natural pregnancy, their body is actually not prepared enough untuk dia pregnant. So in most cases, perempuan tu akan terpaksa kurangkan aktiviti fizikal terlalu dengan sangat-sangat kurang. So some of the people I know terpaksa be in bed rest, okay? Terpaksa ambil cuti kerja, terpaksa duduk berehat je atas katil, kalau berjalan sikit ada risiko untuk dia keguguran. Those kind of problem ada, okay? And I mentioned tadi prosedurnya painful, especially for the female partner lah, okay? So kalau you tengok dekat sini, ini proses yang dia buat. I mentioned tadi dia keluarkan ovum daripada badan, okay? So a few ovums are collected. Dan dia tunjuk pada you kat sini, okay, those ovum tadi, ni, dia simpan, alright. There are a few things yang dia buat, okay, some dia akan guna terus untuk implantation. However, ini pun bergantung kepada the health of the female lah, sebab doktor akan check, dan the more dia letak dalam female punya, apa tu, uterus, the lower the chance untuk pregnancy tu berjaya. Okay, doktor selalunya akan suggest dia implant satu atau dua sahaja at any time of the fertilized egg tadi. Okay, kalau letak terlalu banyak, ada risiko untuk keguguran lah. Okay, so ini bergantung. Tapi selalunya dia tak akan letak satu je lah. Sebab tu kalau orang yang buat IVF, dia ada chance yang agak tinggi untuk dapat pregnancy twins. Okay, sebab memang doktor akan implant beberapa ovum untuk increase the chance of actually they are implanting. And the rest, doktor akan simpan lah. Sebab tu dia extract banyak sekaligus, because they can actually store them for future use. Kalau pregnant atau tak berjaya pregnant, at least ada backup. Okay, kalau pregnant nak lagi, boleh ambil yang sample lama. Atau dah try sekali, tak berjaya. I know a friend yang dah cuba dua kali, masih gagal untuk pregnant. So dia boleh go back kepada sample dia tadi untuk try lagi sekali lah, macam tu. Alright. So Kalau you tengok prosesnya, inilah datangnya di mana perkataan IVF tu. Because fertilization berlaku di luar badan, in vitro. Dan kalau bahasa Melayu disebut bayi tabung uji. Dia sebenarnya bukan bayi tabung uji, dia bayi piripetri. Okay, it's done in a petri dish. Okay, dan ada dua cara lah how fertilization can be induced to occur. Okay, dalam petri dish yang dah ada di ovum tadi, dia mungkin sembur je the sperm. Kalau sperm tu sihat dan banyak, atau kalau sperm male pun tak berapa nak sihat, what they can do is actually buat direct fertilization, cucuk. Okay, dia suntik the sperm directly into the ovum. Okay, sebab ovum ni dia ada outer layer yang keras ni kat luar ni. Dia bukanlah keras tapi outer layer that is protective that needs to be penetrated. So kalau male punya sperm tu tak berapa nak kuat dan dia mungkin tak boleh penetrate normally, this increase the chance untuk berlaku fertilization lah. So doktor akan pilih mana yang paling sesuai untuk the couple. Alright, but eventually apa yang berlaku once dia dah fertilize, dia akan biar. Okay, kalau you tengok dia tunjuk pada you tadi, ini proses yang berlaku dalam badan manusia juga normally. Alright, if there is fertilization, this is what happen. Ini mitosis lah daripada satu sel yang fertilize tadi, okay, and then dia akan divide by mitosis untuk jadi dua sel. Okay, then dia divide lagi untuk jadi 4 cells, 8 cells, until one point kita dapat inilah a ball of cell. Ini ialah your morula. Okay, kalau you ingat kita cerita development of embryo hari tu up to morula. Then sampai kepada uterus, dia akan dah differentiate into blastocyst. Yang tu yang akan menempel. Okay. Dan ini dia assist by biasanya sebab dia di fertilize in vitro, dia mungkin tak mampu nak hatch keluar daripada coating luar dia ni. So apa yang doktor mungkin akan buat, dia tebuk lubang sikit lah supaya content kat dalam ni boleh keluar. Sebab you tengok tadi dia tunjuk pada you hatching process tu berlaku naturally dalam badan manusia. Kat mana tadi? Sini. Okay. Ini hatching process disebut pada you. The inside yang duduk dalam envelope luar ni mesti keluar. Baru dia boleh implant. So ini yang dia buat dalam lab lah. Dia buat ni tujuannya supaya chance untuk berlaku implantation dan pregnancy tu dia boleh increase setinggi mungkin. Okay. Boleh?
Boleh.
Boleh faham the procedure yang ditunjukkan pada you?
Faham.
Okay, ini antara yang paling common lah. IVF antara option yang paling common sekarang, and quite luckily di Malaysia pun kesedaran tu makin ada lah. Kalau dulu dia satu benda yang mungkin ada stigma sikit lah. People look down on orang yang opt for IVF sebab ada dia bagilah title tak subur lah, infertile lah macam-macam. But now with the current teknologi ni, ini yang dia minta you discuss tu, activity zone tu, what are the benefits and drawbacks of the current technology. Okay, drawbacks ni ada quite a few. Macam teacher mention tadi, in some country, the ethical issue ni is that it could actually menggalakkan pregnancy out of wedlock lah. Okay, pregnant tanpa kahwin, macam tu. So in most community, kebanyakan agama tak benarkan benda macam tu. So itu ada ethical issue-nya di situ. Because our advancement in technology resulted in us being able to actually conceive without having partner. So this could be a supportive tool untuk say golongan LGBT, macam tu lah. Okay, golongan yang sejenis dia memang tak boleh pregnant. So dia boleh guna this technology untuk support dia punya activity I guess. Tapi ada ethical issue di situ. Okay, and selalunya ethical issue-nya melibatkan religious lah. Alright, ada soalan setakat ini?
Tak ada.
Okay, I hope yang teacher share ni boleh bantu you dapat idea of the available technology. Kita ada a few more technology yang mungkin lebih advanced, tapi teacher tak nak discuss yang tu because that is for you to do. So that being said, okay. Sekejap, teacher tunjuk. Okay, this activity zone teacher nak you buat tolong cari. Okay, kalau boleh buat dalam bentuk esei. Kalau malas nak buat dalam bentuk esei, boleh buat dalam bentuk peta minda ke, okay, atau table. You can just list down apa the technology dia, apa dia punya pros, apa dia punya cons. Macam tu je. Tak perlu buat dalam apa tu, esei panjang pun tak apa. Yang teacher tak nak ialah you copy paste, copy paste. Because copy pasting usually does not involve reading. Teacher nak you membaca. Okay, so go cari beberapa. Alright, beberapa technology contributions dalam reproduction, human reproduction, 4 to 5 technologies. Then cari apa dia punya benefit, apa dia punya drawback. Okay, better yet you share your information yang you dapat tu dengan kawan-kawan. In case you teknologi yang you jumpa lain dengan yang kawan you, at least that save time untuk you. Tak perlulah nak membaca semua. Okay, boleh?
Boleh teacher.
For this teacher nak you buat dalam masa, I'll give you 1 week. So hari ni 11 hari bulan 10, this one will due, okay, dalam bentuk essay atau dalam bentuk peta minda, due in seminggu 18 hari bulan 10. Okay? Boleh? Dapat tu semua?
Dapat.
Okay, so this one due 18 Oktober. Buat yang ni je, activity zone. Alright, sebab soalannya tak ada. Dia tanya apa cost of importancy ada ni dekat sini. Dia dah list down, teacher tak perlu nak go through it too much lah. Alright, kalau you tengok soalan lain berkaitan okay, dia akan bagi pada you, ini yang teacher bimbang dengan reproduction. Dia suka bagi soalan melibatkan masalah semasa atau masalah kesihatan. Okay, kalau you tengok satu dia bagi dekat sini, yang ni. Alright, explain why pregnant mothers must stop smoking. Dia tak discuss sangat dalam you punya syllabus, tapi ada keluar dalam soalan. Dan bila soalannya explain, markah paling kurang 2 markah ni. Okay. So yang ni, kalaupun you malas nak jawab sendiri, access the answer scheme supaya you tahu apa jawapan untuk dia. Okay, and then number 6, tengok dia cakap a woman took contraceptive pill. Nah, ni teacher mention tadi. Okay, contraception tak di include dalam buku teks you, tapi ada soalannya. Itu masalahnya. Contraception ada beberapa eh. Contraception ni ialah untuk prevent pregnancy. Okay, kalau kita tengok. Okay, ini salah satu, ini device, contraceptive device yang kita panggil IUD, intrauterine device. Dan intrauterine device ni dia small device macam ni yang dia akan insert, doktor akan insert masuk ke dalam uterus perempuan. Okay, dan dia akan letak dalam situasi macam ni, dalam keadaan macam ni, dalam uterus, so that dia boleh prevent any possible embryo daripada menempel. Okay, dia sebenarnya dia prevent dinding rahim daripada menebal dan dia prevent implantation. Ini salah satu contraceptive method yang antara yang paling berkesan lah. Okay, other than that dia boleh include pill yang macam soalan ni sebut lah. Dia ambil pill, biasanya dia ialah hormon lah. Okay, the hormone akan mimic hormon badan you dan dia akan prevent the natural process tu. So kalau you ambil hormon, in this case, dia inhibit FSH. So kalau dia inhibit FSH, bermaksud follicle tak boleh grow. Sometimes dia akan bagi hormon yang inhibit thickening of the endometrium wall. Macam tu lah. Okay? Anything that will disrupt the normal menstrual cycle tadi, kita boleh guna untuk contraception. Okay? Prevention of pregnancy. Atau other methods yang you mungkin biasa dengar ialah physical dan natural punya contraception lah. Yang ni boleh google je. Teacher, dulu teacher share tapi sini, you boleh google. Ini sahaja dia akan share pada you. Ada banyak. Okay, contraceptive methods ada banyak. Yang ni kalau yang biasa you dengar, teacher buka ini. Alright, kalau you biasa dengar, ini berbentuk physical, kondom lah. Okay, dan kondom ada dua jenis, male dan female. Ini dia prevent entry of sperm. Okay, dia kurang berkesan kalau tak digunakan dengan betul lah. Sebab kondom mungkin boleh koyak atau tak dipakai dengan betul, sperm masih boleh keluar lah. Tapi ini antara contraceptive method yang paling common digunakan. Okay, ini oral contraception ni maknanya makan pil. Okay, makan pil ni perempuan selalunya akan kena makan setiap hari. So chance untuk dia berjaya pun boleh kurang kalau perempuan tu tertinggal makan. Yang lebih kurang, yang lebih tinggi chance untuk berjaya ialah kalau ambil injection lah. Nah, ini pergi cucuk. Kalau you biasa bercakap dengan mak you, mungkin you pernah dengar lah. Okay, pergi cucuk. Cucuk ni cucuk hormon lah. Okay, atau implant. Implant ni macam ni. Okay, you nampak dia macam Roger. Implant ni dia device kecil yang dia akan letak bawah kulit di lengan. Okay. Doktor akan doreh sikit kulit kat lengan untuk masukkan the implant, dan implant ni akan secrete hormon sikit-sikit. Dia sama je macam makan ubat, cuma you tak perlu makan. Okay, dia diletak dalam badan, dia keluarkan sendiri. So you tak perlu bimbang terlupa makan ke apa. Okay, and then yang lain tak perlu nak ni sangat. Surgical sterilization ni ialah buat apa surgery lah. Sama ada untuk perempuan, dia akan ikat the fallopian tube. Dia potong fallopian tube dan ikat. Okay, untuk lelaki dia potong sperm duct. Okay, duct untuk sperm keluar tu dia akan potong dan ikat. Okay, itu surgical sterilization, dan dia biasanya permanent lah. Boleh reverse dia, tapi jarang lah berjaya. Doktor boleh buka balik ikatan dan cuba sambung dengan surgery the tube yang dipotong tadi, tapi selalunya dia lebih permanent. Dan ini mungkin you akan jumpa perkataan tubal ligation. Okay, sini teacher tak boleh nak contoh. You mungkin akan jumpa perkataan tubal or tube ligation. Okay, ligation ni ialah that action, potong dan ikat. Okay, so dia ialah surgery lah. Kalau jumpa perkataan tubal ligation ni, dia refer kepada surgery tadi. Sama ada surgery of fallopian tube untuk perempuan atau surgery of the sperm duct untuk lelaki. Okay. Apa lagi tadi? Saya tunjuk pada tadi. Okay. Then yang lain, ini ni ialah natural method. Sebab tu kita ajar pada you the female menstrual cycle. Kalau you boleh keep track, kalau you tengok video tadi dia cakap when the ovum is released daripada the ovary, duduk dalam fallopian tube, itu ialah tempoh subur perempuan. So high chance kalau dia buat sexual intercourse sebelum, semasa atau selepas. So if you follow correctly the menstrual cycle of female, dan kalau female punya menstrual cycle tu constant, okay, then you can rancang secara semula jadilah ni orang cakap. Okay, ni merancang secara natural macam tu. Cuma ini sangat berisiko lah, sebab most female dia punya menstrual cycle dia tak tetap. You don't know exactly sebenarnya bila ovulation berlaku. So you kena give and take weeks lah selalunya. So for most cases tak berjaya sangat lah. Doktor kalau you betul nak merancang, doktor akan bagi option sama ada implant atau IUD, or at least makan ubat perancang. Okay, pil perancang. Boleh?
Boleh.
So ya, yeah, ya. Yeah.
Saya nak tanya. Saya ada terbaca somewhere kalau kita makan pil tu kan, dia boleh regulate period, betul ke?
Yes, because pil ni boleh diberi dalam beberapa situasi. Sama ada you nak prevent pregnancy atau you nak menggalakkan pregnancy. Kalau you jenis yang, perempuan tu jenis yang pregnancy period dia tak regular. Period tak regular ni bermaksud hormon dia tak regular. So apa yang doktor akan buat kalau dia nak pregnant, doktor akan bagi pil dulu untuk susun balik dia punya period, supaya kita boleh agak bila dia punya ovulation. Boleh? Betul? Boleh berlaku?
Thank you.
Okay. Ada lagi soalan?
Teacher, nak tanya. Macam kita tahu that ovum ni, ovum yang mati ni, dia akan keluar sekali dengan darah haid kan? Tapi bila if one did a tubal ligation tu, so jadi macam dia kena sekat ataupun kena potong kan pada penyakit dia kan. Jadi dia tak boleh nak pergi macam pergi kat uterus apa semua tu kan. Ovum, even after operation tu, ovum still lagi produce, tapi ovum tu dia reput macam tu je ke dalam ovary?
Okay. Your body has a way to remove dead cell. Dia, kita kira dia sebagai dead cell lah. Okay, you do have, selalunya it might get dissolved. Ada enzyme yang akan break down the cell. So, cellular component yang boleh diguna, kita akan recycle balik. Yang tak boleh diguna, biasanya kita akan remove melalui our excretory system lah. Sama ada dia akan keluar melalui urine atau dia akan keluar melalui your feces. Okay. Ataupun, it might get digested by macrophage. Okay, you ada phagocytes dalam badan you that could also ingest dan digest dead cell. Okay, boleh?
Boleh.
So, dia tak akan berkumpul lah dalam badan. Your body have a way of cleaning up dead cell. Sebab kita memang sel dalam badan you memang mati all the time. So, dia ada cara untuk remove that lah. Okay. Ada lagi soalan?
Teacher.
Ya. Yeah.
Pasal kan lepas kita ikat fallopian tube tu, apa potong tu kan, period kita still datang ke?
Datang sebab hormon you masih dikeluarkan seperti biasa. Fallopian tube is not responsible for any hormone production. So macam yang kawan ni sebut tadilah, okay. Kalau kita potong, alright, ini. You punya reproductive system ni. Okay, kalau dalam female, dia akan potong. Biasanya dia akan potong kat sini. Okay, dia akan potong dan dia akan ikat. Cut dan ikat lah. Okay, dua side ni, belah sini dan belah sini dia akan ikat. So, ovary masih intact. So, ovum akan keluar. Tapi yang macam kawan ni cakap tadi, dia akan mati di sini. Sperm tak boleh sampai pada dia. Okay. So even if ada berlaku sexual intercourse pun, sperm tak sampai lah sebab dah jalan ni dah diputuskan. Okay. So yang mati dekat sini ni, you masih dapat ovum production. You masih ada corpus luteum dalam ni. So dinding uterus you masih akan menebal. So masih berlaku menstrual cycle macam biasa. Cuma there is chance that dia akan terganggu the regularity lah, dia punya apa kita panggil cycle, tempo cycle dia tu mungkin akan terganggu. Sebab if you don't have the normal natural course tu, biasa macam you ambil pil pun sama, dia akan mengganggu the hormonal balance. Dan kalau hormonal balance dia terganggu sikit pun, chances are menstrual cycle dia akan terganggu lah. Tapi you shouldn't have problem getting your menstruation macam biasa. Okay?
Okay.
Untuk lelaki, kita potong sperm duct. Kat sini lah. Okay. Dia akan cut di sini. Boleh? Ada soalan lagi?
Okay.
Ya, ya.
Take pregnancy tu macam mana?
Amna?
Take pregnancy.
Fake pregnancy?
Oh.
Fake. Dia it could be fake pregnancy ni lebih kepada psychological lah. You nak tanya pregnancy yang imaginary pregnancy atau pregnancy luar rahim?
Luar rahim.
Kalau luar rahim, pregnancy luar rahim berlaku bila ini. I should have just shared that. Okay, bila kalau you tengok human reproductive system untuk female, okay. Kalau ditunjuk pada you tadi, the ovum are supposed to, after fertilization, okay, selepas dah di-fertilize, ovum akan travel down the fallopian tube, okay, dan pergi kepada ovary. Pergi kepada uterus dan menempel di sini. Pregnancy luar rahim, bahasa Inggerisnya, you mungkin akan jumpa ectopic pregnancy dia panggil, okay. Ectopic pregnancy ialah pregnancy tapi berlaku di luar rahim. Bermaksud ovum tadi tak sampai di uterus, dia dah menempel. Biasanya dia menempel kat sini lah. Di dalam fallopian tube. Okay. Ada cases di mana the uterus is found to develop anywhere here in the layer luar. Okay. Instead of in the endometrium, dia di exo. Kita tak panggil exo. The outer uteral lining, okay, lining luar uterus, alright, itu dikira sebagai ectopic pregnancy, pregnancy luar rahim kalau baby dia develop luar daripada kawasan ni, Okay, boleh berlaku dan bahayalah. Alright, sebab kalau dia develop menempel dekat sini, dia develop dan ada risiko fallopian tube dia pecah. Okay, so it's going to be very painful untuk perempuan. Boleh? Kalau apa tu imaginary pregnancy, itu biasanya psychological condition lah, dan it is an existing psychological condition. Bermaksud perempuan tu rasa macam dia pregnant dan dia over dia undergo perubahan fizikal seperti dia pregnant, tapi sebenarnya dia tak pregnant. That is more to issues dengan psikologi lah. Okay, so we don't touch in on that lah. I do not have much knowledge on that. Okay. Boleh? Ada soalan lagi? So, kalau you tengok, I mentioned tadi soalan-soalan topik ni dia melibatkan benda yang kadang-kadang, ini masalah dengan buku teks, kadang-kadang tak dibincang dalam any of the syllabus, tapi tiba-tiba muncul dalam soalan. Ini yang pemeriksa kertas SPM cakap. Sebab tu buku teks sekarang, KSSM, pelajar kena khatam daripada awal sampai habis. Dari muka depan sampai muka belakang. Semua benda. Okay. Brainstorm, activity zone, apa lagi dia punya ni yang dia bagi. Science fact, semua. Soalan, jawapan, semua you kena go through. Okay. Sebab apa yang ada dalam buku teks boleh keluar dalam SPM. Ha, itu je dia punya argument. Kalau you cakap tak ada dalam syllabus, ada ni dalam soalan. Dia keluarkan dalam soalan. Bermaksud dia boleh tanya dalam SPM. Okay? So, teacher minta tolong kalau pun malas menjawab soalan, ni access answer scheme, ni scan QR code ni, access answer scheme. Okay? Supaya you boleh tahu soalan ni apa jawapan dia, soalan ni apa jawapan dia. Okay? Boleh?
Boleh.
Okay, ada soalan lain? Teacher tak suruh you jawab lah ni. Okay, kalau you tengok ini sangat common. Macam yang macam soalan atas tadi, ini ialah untuk overcome masalah dia. Ini infertility. Kalau atas tadi untuk prevent pregnancy, soalan yang ini, soalan ni untuk membolehkan dia pregnant. So, ada dua situasi di mana kita guna teknologi tu. So, tolong baca. Teacher tak suruh you jawab soalan essay atau enrichment. Teacher minta you buat activity zone je lah. Yang ni kita akan buat later kalau ada masa. Kalau tak ada masa, kita chances are akan go through this again bila dekat-dekat nak exam SPM nanti. Okay? Boleh? Alright. Ada soalan? Untuk kelas seterusnya, kita akan habiskan chapter terakhir form 5 ni, form 4 ni, which is 15.7, growth in human and animal. Dia topik yang pendek. Okay, ada beberapa proses baru yang you akan belajar, tapi it's not anything complicated. InsyaAllah boleh habis dalam satu period. And then kami akan discuss lah unit bio. Esok baru cikgu-cikgu sains bekerja. So we will be discussing tomorrow where to take from that. Now from there, dah habis syllabus form 4, chances are high chance bahawa kita akan belajar syllabus form 5 lah. But I will let you know later what's the plannya, dan tolong bersedia buat revision sebab there is very high chance kamu akan kembali ke sekolah to sit for ujian semester. Kalau kamu kembali ke sekolah to sit for ujian semester bertulis, dan ujian semester kamu akan berformat penuh lah. Kita tak akan ada kertas 3 amali, tapi you akan sit for paper 1 and paper 2. Okay, paper 2 ialah paper structure format penuh. So structure tu ada soalan structure pendek dan soalan essay. So teacher minta tolong mulakan revision you sekarang, sementara you ada akses kepada internet, sementara you masih boleh belajar dengan cara yang interaktif dan fun, guna kelebihan yang ada tu untuk buat revision sekarang. Okay. Kalau rasa too much, overwhelming, start dengan topik-topik yang you rasa mudah. Alright. I will reconfirm dengan Cikgu Azida, penyelaras form 4 nanti, apa topik form 4 yang akan keluar dalam semester exam you. Then you boleh mula rancang lah. Okay. But definitely topik-topik belakang ni akan keluar. Okay. So boleh mula revise dengan topik-topik yang baru teacher ajar, dan sebenarnya topik-topik bermula dari topik 10 tu, itu topik yang susah. Kita consider dia sebagai topik yang susah lah dalam biology, human punya anatomy, fisiologi. Okay? Alright, so teacher minta tolong bersedia untuk yang tu. I will not be spending too much time untuk revision sebab I assume pelajar boleh buat sendiri. If we have remaining time sebelum ujian semester, I will probably go into chapter form 5 lah. Alright. Okay, I will end the session here. Ada soalan sebelum teacher akhiri kelas? Let me reconfirm. Fahim masuk ke tak masuk? Tak masuk. Siapa-siapa tahu dia pergi mana? Class President tak tahu Fahim pergi mana?
Tak tahu.
Dia tak ada bagi tahu sesiapa?
Tak.
Kelas sebelum ni masuk ke tak? Kelas tadi masuk sebelum kelas bio teacher?
Admit tadi teacher guna apa tu? Team attenders. Tak tahu.
Okay. Tak apalah. Alright, if nobody knows, then teacher consider dia sebagai ponting lah. Alright, kalau tak ada soalan, that's all for today. Okay, I will see you guys again minggu depan untuk habiskan chapter 4. Kita mungkin akan spend satu period untuk go through balik some of the chapters. Tapi lepas tu kita mungkin akan masuk chapter 5 lah. So bersedia. Alright, itu sahaja. Thank you for your attention, your attendance. I will see you guys again later. Assalamualaikum.
Thank you, sir.